I've got kind of a double-barreled question, both around what the current barriers you all think are kind of prevalent in Europe, and also what is it that, in your opinion, makes the cannabis space so so difficult to navigate?
Sure, I'll get in there first. I suppose just to answer the question first on what makes the cannabis space so difficult to navigate, possibly its legal status and the stigma attached to it. I mean, those have got to be the two main things. At the moment, I think other barriers have to be the pandemic, because anyone that this issue is being brought to, they're saying, well, this is the priority, the pandemic is the priority. That's totally understandable. But as well, the stigma. And I have to say, personally, coming from Ireland, the lack of ability to critically analyze the data that's being put out by prohibitionists is a massive barrier, because I think there's this idea that these individuals behind these reports and statistics are infallible when they're not. We need to be able to recognize the way in which they bias, they come at these studies with bias, and they are manipulating data in order for it to fit their narrative. We need to call that out at every opportunity. It's not enough for us to say that it's wrong. We need to actually highlight why it's wrong, provide evidence proving that it's wrong, and share that information with as many people as possible. Again, I mentioned, you know, the stigma attached to it. Anyone that this is being brought to, the main issue I'm coming up against is they hear cannabis, they think drugs, they think bad. And it's kind of being dismissed as this issue of people just wanting to get high. And I'm always saying that's not the case whatsoever. We just want sensible policy to be implemented, because at the moment, prohibition doesn't work. Everyone knows this. So we need to come up with a better strategy. I just feel like these psychiatrists and members of government, they don't see what's in front of them. They're content to blame cannabis for these issues when it's actually prohibition that's causing the issues. It's contaminated cannabis. It's an unregulated market. It's no testing, no labeling. Why this is such an out there concept for them to grasp, I'm not understanding. And I just hope that they do eventually see that prohibition is the issue, not cannabis itself.
Well, I totally agree with Nicole. Thank you very much for mentioning this. It's the same problem everywhere, you know, the prohibition. And how do people see cannabis? Cannabis is not a bad thing. Cannabis was always used and was legal. And then for some reason, it was illegalized. So we don't have to legalize, actually. We have to re-legalize. We have to come back to the roots and see the plant as what it is. It is a plant, and it's a plant that has benefits. You know, if I go, if I grow sage in my garden and I consume too much, these tolines, whatever is in there, it can harm me. You know, St. John's Wort can harm me if I take too much, but I'm allowed to do it. So what I think, why is it so difficult to navigate cannabis is, first, it grows everywhere. Everybody can grow it. So the big lobbies are the problem. They see there's a market. They want the monopolies. They want to lead the market. And now there's these licenses that are so expensive, so only the big companies can buy it. And the small growers, who are actually all the activists, who have the best knowledge, the best expertise for it, yeah, they don't have the money to get in, and that's the problem. You know, there's no financial profit in it if it's done on a social and fair way.
The good thing I think about that is that indeed there is no profit, so there is no real lobby for, say, home growing. But on a human rights level, on a fundamental level, and this could work also for media if you get them to listen, this is the best point, you know. For us as VOC, as organization, the right to home growing, it always precedes any commercial shop or whatever, even a cannabis social club. If it's your own apartment, if it's your own garden or balcony, the government has no business whatsoever to do it. So I think you can use that fact, and you can, at least for some of the politicians, you can convince them that you are sort of critical of big business, that you don't really want big time advertising, billboards advertising cannabis. You first of all want the fundamental right to grow your own medicine or your own therapeutical herb. You touched on that before, and it's indeed a very interesting discussion and debate. Is any use of cannabis medical? And I think the use of a word like therapeutical sort of solves it and bridges the gap between the two. Because I couldn't say whether I use my weed recreational or medical, but it makes me feel a lot better than when I don't use it. So for me, it's a therapeutical thing. But it's very hard for politicians to get to understand this, I must admit.
I think with regard to the barriers today that we have in front of cannabis legalization, and first of all, let me clarify, because I didn't do it at the very beginning. In Italy, medical cannabis is allowed, even if we have enormous problems, because a lot of sick people do not have enough product. So, but that's something we may mention later. In terms of what is the situation, I think that there are two aspects very clear in Italy, at least. One is the stigma, and means that people are ignorant in the good sense, of course, because in the 70s and 80s, drug was, in all the world, a very big problem. And nobody explained to people that cannabis is something very different from cocaine and heroin, of course. So if I cannot blame my grandmother, if you go to my grandmother and says, I want to legalize cannabis, and you say, what is that? It's a drug. So drug is death. So there are entire generation that grew up in ignorance, and that's a fact. So this is a course of action, of course, to inform people. And the second fact is that politics, I would say, the populist or whoever is interested to find enemies leverage on the cannabis as a fear. No? So in fact, they do the equation. Just today on the newspaper, the leader of our right party said that we are against death. And of course, people do not know that nobody is dying for cannabis, even if abuse is harmful, of course. But people simply die more for nicotine and for smoking and alcohol. So it is so important to discuss it, because in Italy, the discussion in parliament, all the experts were in favor. And I would also like to mention the fact that there is a big, big difference in generation. Once you go in the surveys, it is clear that today the public opinion is 50-50 in favor and against legalization. It was 30% in favor 10 years ago, so it's growing. But if you go on the youngest generation, this is 60 or 70% in favor. And I just take another minute to mention something that concerns us as a political party in particular. We usually say try to form our policies starting from listening tours with normal people, of course. And I used to be the city lead for Rome. We used to do that. And we had different tables. And one was, what about the security in our city, of course? No, nobody was mentioning cannabis at all. And so I used to do something that we shouldn't do as table, let's say, manager, and I just asked it explicitly, what about cannabis? And everybody was saying, but this is not an issue. So for especially for young generation, this is not an issue. And I do agree, it is not an issue at all. So I think that also this fact about generation is so important, because once you know it, and once you see, I mean, you do the experience of cannabis. Of course, you are able to distinguish between cannabis and the dangerous drugs.
If I could add to this, this is really has been the cornerstone of Dutch drug policy since 1976. From then on, we had a clear distinction in the law between, on the one hand, cannabis products, so hash and wheat and everything that comes off the plant, And on the other end, all the other illegal drugs like cocaine and speed and heroin. So this has been one of the great things about the Dutch policy, is that I was born in 1971 and this policy was introduced in 76. So I know very, very well that there's a big, big difference between cannabis on the one hand and those other drugs on the other hand. And I am very convinced that so many Dutch young people in that respect have been, let's say, saved almost by the coffee shop system. Because if you are curious to smoke some hash or some weed and you can only get it at a dealer that has the full assortment of illegal drugs, of course you are more, there's a bigger chance that you will also try these other drugs. Whereas if you can go as a curious young person to a normal regulated place like a coffee shop, where they are very, very strict that there's never any hard drugs in there because they will lose their license instantly for 3 months at least or be closed down forever. That's a really, really important thing. And I think for all the European countries now going through the reform, this is the youth cards that you can all use. You know, I have 3 children myself. I'm really happy that they can go if they want to buy it at a normal shop and not be, introduced to all kinds of shit that I don't want them to use. And they know also for a fact that there's such a big difference between the drugs. And I know from a lot of people in foreign countries that are working in addiction care, because the police are so heavily involved in getting all the cannabis out, there's always hard drugs, but sometimes there's hardly any weed. And then they just see the people that usually buy the hash off the illegal market, then they go on to the other stuff. So there's your real gateway. The gateway is the police policing all the cannabis so that there's nothing else left. So I think the youth card would be a good thing to get the politicians over to our side, because you are helping the criminals and you are really helping the dealers and you are really making the access to hard drugs a lot easier if you don't have a regulated cannabis sales system.
Absolutely. I think prohibition is definitely the main gateway rather than cannabis itself. It's the system that's in place at the moment.
And can I just add for 20 seconds, sorry to jump inside, but I will not do it in the future. Just to remember that during the discussion in the parliament, the head of police in Italy was in favor, so he spent words in favor of legalization, because it is clear that this would free the resources of police to go after more important crimes. So it is something that is clear also, even if, of course, they are very prudent in doing this statement. But I think that the point of that is it's so important to distinguish between drug and other substances. This is something that didn't happen in Italy, in the public opinion, for the oldest generation yet.
Yes, when I heard this question, what makes a cannabis space so difficult to navigate, I thought, well, is it so? And I don't think so. I never thought it's especially difficult to navigate. In the 90s, I cared about a couple of several political issues, and there are others at least as difficult to navigate. In the cannabis space, there were not many people around caring about it, just a handful of people who really, it's their main issue or something, who are really people influencing the whole issue. And it's very easy to learn them all know very fast. So I always thought, well, that's not so difficult. And also the arguments are all on our side. With other issues, you can say, well, this argument is for this side and this for that side. And well, let's see. And cannabis legalization is a no-brainer if you look on the data. That's quite clear that this is the only right way to go to legalize. And I always thought, well, this is easier than other political issues. Maybe the only thing what makes it difficult is the fear. It was always difficult to get this to the point of a mass movement with millions and thousands of people on the streets and so on, because people did not want to be seen and bound with this issue because maybe they have some plants at home, or even only 2 grams. They are criminals, and they want to hide a bit and so on, and don't show their face for the issue. And it's still the case. We can mobilize, meanwhile, a lot of people. It is a mass movement kind of right now, but still you see it here and there that people still are hiding a little bit. Especially when you try to get celebrities into it, like in the States, it was a big breakthrough when all the Hollywood stars started to say anything about it and saying cannabis legalization makes sense for me. And that is still difficult to achieve in Germany, at least, probably in other countries also. But all the other things, well, not too difficult to navigate. But the barriers are there, of course. You have them in every issue. Like, for example, if you compare with climate policy or traffic, let's say we want a completely different traffic, all public transport, and get all the cars out of the game and so on, and save the climate. Well, that is difficult to navigate with many more people interested in and much more money involved against you. The car industry, for example, in Germany, well, that is powerful. And there is the legalization debate. There is not much money against it. It's the dealers. They are the only ones who want it like it is, who earn as it is. But they don't go to the politician and say, here, you've got 100,000 euros and look that they don't legalize. Well, I never heard about that. They have no lobby or something real organized, at least not. So it's easier. The barriers, I would say, first is police. So it was interesting to hear from Italy that the police, highest police guy there said legalization is nice. Here it's not so. Here police is with all the associations, police associations and so on, several different ones and all against legalization, and they are everywhere. After you discuss something with experts, there's always one of them in the panel and always against legalization. So for me, this is the biggest barrier. But that's not a financial or money lobby or something like that. And the other thing is conservative policy and left policy. On the other hand, the left parties were the first who understood that legalization is the way to go, and it's the only thing that makes sense. Maybe because in former times it were the more left-leaning student movement and so on who were consuming, the same reason why they put pressure on it on the other side. And it's still the same game in Germany. I said four of the parties are want legalization, more on the left side, and the conservatives, I think now it's more like a reflex. We can't do it because it's an issue of the left side. It's a left issue somehow, but it isn't. Well, and it has nothing to do with law and order. Law and order is the main key issue for our conservatives, as they meanwhile don't know anymore what does conservative mean, you know, what is conservative. But law and order, that's their issue. And so they first thought is, well, law and order and legalizing cannabis doesn't fit together. And that's something we have got to explain them, that legalization is law and order, and that what we are doing now is the opposite of law and order.
Yeah.